My name is Jim Nelson, the Director of Athletics Emeritus at Suffolk University. And I'm here this morning, Friday, October 18th, 2018, with Herb Santos Sr. Herb is a 1958 graduate of Suffolk University and a 1960 graduate of our law school. And Herb is making a return here to New England. He's accompanied with his son, Corey, and his granddaughter, Olivia. And we're pleased to welcome you all back to New England. Herb, you grew up in Plainfield, Connecticut. Now, back in the 1950s, there were very few people coming to Suffolk University from Plainfield, Massachusetts. Nonetheless, from Plainfield, Connecticut. And my understanding is Plainfield is a little bit west of Hartford, and you grew up on a farm with two brothers and four sisters. And do you remember some of those days on the farm, and what kind of farm was it?
It was a small farm. We raised chickens, turkeys, and we had a pig. Of course, every year we had a pig. And the garden was actually in front of our house. We had about an acre and a half of garden, and a lot of work.
Yeah.
Weeds and stuff. But Plainville was a small town. In fact, the railroad tracks ran right through the center of town. And we used to walk on the railroad tracks to get to town. We had one movie theater. And that movie theater, the price to go to it was 10 cents. My mother used to give me 15 cents, and 5 cents I used for buying candy. And we used to buy these walnuttos, and they were about a foot long, and they'd last through the entire showing of the films. We used to have Hopalong Cassidy was our John Wayne.
Sure.
And we see Ever G. Robinson, James Cagney. There were two maiden features, a newsreel and a cartoon for the entire showing. The only big things that I remember happening in Plainville was Barnum and Bailey Circus would come to town once a year, and we would go work at the circus helping them put up the tents and things, and they would let us get in free.
Oh, interesting.
And the other thing was Doris Day came through town, the whole town without the greeter. She was on the end of a railroad train and waved to the crowd, and it was really something to see her. That was the first time I saw a movie star in person. But there was a lot of work. The only thing I didn't like about Plainville was every fall they had to butcher the pig.
Oh, my.
And we had this guy, his name was Quinto, and he would appear, and he had black clothes on and a black hat, and he had a black briefcase, and I used to have nightmares of him because in the briefcase, he had three big knives, and the knives were, they looked like they were daggers, you know. It was unbelievable.
And this was a pig that he was going to slaughter that grew up with for the whole year.
Yeah, the thing that I didn't like when I was old enough, I had to hold the some ropes that they hung the pig up, and I had to hold the rope, and oh, it was terrible. It was terrible. I mean, he'd kill the pig right away, but, you know, the pig would squeal. And,
oh, my.
I used to have nightmares of that stuff.
And I understand, speaking of Plainville, that you were inducted into the Plainville High School Hall of Fame. Can you tell us a little bit about that experience?
Oh, that was wonderful. In fact, Corey's the one that set that up.
Corey, your son, yeah.
Yeah, my son. We went out to Plainville, Connecticut, and of course we went to where my house was. It was gone, and everything has changed. There was another big house there, and there was a big park that I used to go fishing in the park, and brought back a lot of memories. And when we visited my mother and father's grave, and that was very nice.
And you played basketball at Plainville High School.
Yeah, basketball, football, and track. In fact, I don't know if you can believe this, but I ran the mile. But I would, I'd always come in second to the last on the mile.
It was. But you finished.
Yeah, I finished.
Good for you. And then after high school, you enrolled in the Navy. Tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, when I graduated from high school, actually I was first going to be go to the Highway Patrol, but the Highway Patrol only wanted guys that were 6 foot and higher.
Mm-hmm.
And so I couldn't qualify for that. Then I was going to be a carpenter, and I was going to go to trade school, learn to be a carpenter. But then I decided to go into the Navy. So I applied for the Navy and went into the Navy, went to Great Lakes Naval Training School for training.
And this was back in the Korean War era?
Yeah, 1950 to 54.
Right.
Yeah. And in the Navy, I went to, after school, they sent me to Bayonne, New Jersey, and I went to the storekeeper school there. And then from there, my assignment was Trinidad, right off the coast of Venezuela.
Yes.
And so I was there for a few years.
Were you on a ship or on a base?
No, we were on a base.
Mm-hmm.
They'd bring cargo ships in, and we'd have to unload them. They didn't have stevedores there, so
right.
We had to unload them. And I remember one day, I was walking across the deck, and my friend was up on a winch, and he called to me, and I waved to him like this, and all of a sudden, I fell right through the hatch, big hatch door. Fortunately, the second floor and the third floor were already blocked off. They were unloaded. So I only fell maybe about 20 feet. So I didn't get hurt.
Good.
There's spikes sticking up right near me, though.
Mm.
And my boss took me to the hospital anyway.
Right.
Checked me out, but I was okay.
And then after Trinidad, were you stationed back in the States after that?
Yeah. But Trinidad, they had so many bad things. They had tiger sharks. They had barracuda.
Mm.
They had bushmaster snakes. They had scorpions. And they had these giant tarantula spiders. They would cover your hand. And
I never see that advertised when they're saying, come to Trinidad for a vacation.
No. But I remember that's where I learned how to drive, actually, too.
On a standard shift?
When I was in Trinidad.
Yeah.
I had a job driving to the different ammo dumps in the nighttime. And they used to have one guy at each ammo dump, and it was frightening for them because, they'd hear all these noises in the jungle and everything else.
Mm-hmm.
And with the snakes and the scorpions and tarantula spiders. But I remember one day, or one night, I was driving to one place to check out the ammo dump in the sailor that was in charge of it. And you had to keep your windows closed.
Sure.
Up. And I'm driving along, and all of a sudden, poof, a big thing came right on the front windshield. It was a big tarantula spider.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah, so you had to keep your windows up all the time.
Put the windshield wipers on.
Oh, trying to creepers.
Flick it off.
But one good thing, the bananas grew wild.
Yes.
And you just pick a banana off the tree, and the bananas, they had such a good taste,
mm-hmm.
not like the store bananas.
Right.
You know, you pick them ripe.
Yeah, and then you got your potassium, and you're probably having bananas now. Your doctor probably recommends, like he does my doctor, good time to have potassium.
Yeah.
Have your bananas in the morning.
You eat them, but there's no taste to them.
Yeah.
But it, and I remember one guy, mangoes used to grow wild there too. And one sailor, one time, we were out in the jungle, and he climbed up the tree to get some mangoes, and he's throwing them down, and all of a sudden, he came down, sliding down the tree, and yelling at the same time. We didn't know what happened. We went over to him, and he was full of, they had the red ants.
Oh, yes, fire ants.
Yeah, fire ants. They were terrible. They were terrible.
Mm.
And every once in a while, if you went golfing, sometimes I'd slice a lot when I golf. And you'd go in the jungle, and then the guy would go in there looking for the ball, and sometimes you'd hear him yell, and he'd come running out, and he had a scorpion bite, you know. It was fun, but it was dangerous.
Time to take up another sport. And after the Navy, how is it that you came to come to Suffolk University? How did you hear about Suffolk University?
My father knew a guy that recommended Suffolk. And so I applied, and I used the GI Bill. Otherwise, I wouldn't have been able to come here.
Right.
And let me see. The first apartment I had with a roommate was on Hancock Street.
Oh, yes. My office is on the corner of Cambridge and Hancock, so I'm very familiar with that.
Yeah. That's where we had the big fire.
Tell us a little bit about that fire. I understand it was a terrible situation.
Yeah, it was terrible. It was the middle of winter, and the snow was deep high. It was in the cars used to park illegally both sides of the streets.
Right.
So it was hard for a fire truck
to
come up.
It's a very narrow street.
Yeah. But I was sleeping, my roommate was sleeping in his bed, and I heard the landlord lived right below us, and I heard his dog bark, and I said, gee, what's the heck's wrong with that? So I got up, and I put on my slippers, and I threw my pants on to go see what was wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And I opened the kitchen door, and a whole hallway was full of flames. So I slammed the door shut.
Oh, my goodness.
And I yelled to my roommate, and he jumped out of bed. And then we realized the whole place was on fire. So we went out the kitchen window, and there's a shed below us. So we jumped down on the shed and got down, and I looked back up at there in our window. The flames were shooting right out of the window, and it seemed to make a curve up into the next apartment above us.
Observe that, you know?
Yeah, and three women were killed.
Terrible.
In the fire. And so we got out on a shed, and then they got a ladder for us. We got down, and they took us to the police station.
Yes.
Got us some clothes.
Yeah, over on Joy Street, there was two streets over, was a small sub-police station over there.
They were very nice.
Yeah.
So they got us some clothes, And then I think 2 days later, they let us go back upstairs in the apartments, see what we can salvage. But I opened a closet door, and just the hangers, all the clothes were burned up, all our books were burned up, everything was burned.
In the middle of winter.
Yeah, the only thing that I saw, I had a $20 bill on a bureau, and it was encased in ice. So I got the $20, but that's all I saw.
That was probably the cost of the rent at that time, $20 a month, not much more.
No, it was very reasonable.
Yeah.
So then I went back to school a few days later and told the professors about the fire. At first they said, boy, that's the biggest one I ever heard. But then they realized, they found out about the fire.
Sure.
So, I had very good classmates, very good, and they let me borrow their notes and things like that so I could get back and do it. But that was really
very
a fire.
Very traumatic, yeah.
Yeah.
And at that time, you said that you went back to the classroom. And I'm sure you recall that there was, Suffolk at that time had only one building.
Yes.
The Archer Building, in which both the undergraduate and the law school had their classes. And do you remember that one building?
Yeah, I remember the one building.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I had wonderful, wonderful professors. Very wonderful.
Yeah. Back at that time, well, we've named some of our buildings and our previous buildings after them. The president was President John E. Fenton Sr., and they named a building after him.
Mm-hmm.
David Sargent, to whom the building that we're in today was named after. Cliff Elias was a wonderful law professor. Excuse me, Catherine
remember.
Judge.
Yeah, I can't remember who my tort professor was.
Uh-huh.
But he's the one that one time he told us about going into the JAG, being a
yes,
Air Force JAG.
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that situation because you served your country twice, the first time obviously being in the United States Navy. And tell us a little bit about the Air Force, where you later became a judge advocate general.
Yeah, that.
How did that? You had a professor who recommended that to you?
Yeah, it was our torts professor, but I can't remember his name. He was very good, very good. Yes, he mentioned going into the JAG. I think he had something to do with the JAG too.
Right.
You know, so. Of course, after the fire, I went home, and my roommate, his father called him home also, so I don't know if he finished college or not, but went into the, applied for the JAG.
Yeah.
Was accepted, went to Lackland Air Force Base for training.
Yeah, and well, let's come back to the matter. I just wanted to, when you were here at Suffolk, I understand you had some part-time jobs, and one of them might have been as a barback.
And
you may have run into some historic figure known to Boston, Massachusetts, in the nation. And who was that?
I was a barback boy and getting glasses for the bar, and it was right outside, when you went through the State House, it was on the right-hand side. They had a bar there, and John F. Kennedy used to go there all the time with his friends and have some drinks there.
Yeah, he lived up on Bowdoin Street, right up there near the 21st Amendment, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so he used to go there a lot. The thing about Kennedy, he never had his wallet. Never had his wallet. You know, everyone used to buy everything for him. But that was interesting. Then I remember Castro came and gave a speech. But when I heard it, I said, gee, that guy's a nut. I mean, he even advocated, he said, since defendant, if they're found guilty, they can plead this to the Supreme Court. He said the district attorney should have the same privilege. They should be able, if they get an acquittal, they should be able to appeal to Supreme Court. And he said things, crazy things like that, and I said, that guy's something else.
Right. So, and while you were an undergraduate, I understand that you played basketball for the Suffolk University team and for my predecessor and an individual that I worked 10 years with as an assistant, a fellow by the name of Charlie Law.
Charlie Law, yeah.
Yeah, and Charlie was the dean of New England coaches. And I have a photo here of your 1956-57 team. And it has some, there you are, sitting down on the front, on the left there.
Yeah.
Don't look much different today than you did back then. Your weight's probably about the same.
Yeah.
And in that photo, some very interesting individuals are there. There's a fellow by the name of Jack Resnick who once scored 75 points in the Suffolk game, the most ever. The tall fella in the back is Eldie Moore. Eldie was the first African-American player to play for Suffolk University. He was from upstate New York. George Doucette is in that photo. George, in addition to playing basketball, later became our head baseball coach and a very successful one. I suspect that photo brings back a few memories to you.
Yeah.
Can you tell me a little bit about your experience playing basketball? Because we did not have our own home court.
You know, that's why I drew a blank. This guy here was my roommate.
No kidding.
Yeah.
And
but I have a bad memory on remembering things that far back.
Yeah.
But I remember these.
Yeah, and because Suffolk did not have their home court, their own, we did not have our own on-campus facility until 1991.
Yeah.
Sometimes you would play games over at the Cambridge YMCA and practice at the West End House down in Blossom Street, which is now part of Mass General Hospital.
Oh, for God.
And Suffolk even played a few games at the Boston Garden, preliminary games before the Celtics games, because back then they weren't drawing that much. And in that year, that's when Bob Cousy, Bill Sharman, Ed McCauley were the stars, and Russell came afterwards on that while you were in law school, and they began to win a number of championships back then.
Yeah, geez. Yeah, that brings back a lot of memories.
And this one here is a photo of you the year that you graduated from law school, and I'm sure you recognize yourself in that photo.
I remember these people here, Joe Sasso. Yeah,
isn't that nice that you remember those individuals?
Yeah.
Now, after the your time in the Air Force, well, tell me a little bit about the Air Force, or where they had you stationed, and is that how you wound up out in Reno?
Okay, after training in Great Lakes, I mean, not Lackland Air Force Base.
Right.
Went to, let me see if I remember the dates here.
And how long was that training at Lackland?
It was a few months.
Okay.
Yeah. And we used to get shots every day. They'd give us injections in the arm. And then we'd have to go out and parade with our rifles, you know, work out with the rifles. And a lot of marching.
Yeah, and your arms were probably pretty sore from getting the shots,
yeah.
And then they had to do all those calisthenic-type workouts.
Yes. Yeah. Some guys would faint when they got the shot. Yeah. And then, let me see, after Lackland, they gave us three states, a choice, Nevada, California, and New Mexico.
Yeah.
And I never was out west, so I picked Nevada, and I got Stead Air Force Base. So before I got sent out to Stead, that's when I met my wife.
Jeanette.
Yeah. And we had four dates. And then I went into the went out to Stead, and that was in 61.
Right.
61.
Just after your law school graduation.
Yeah, and that was nice. We had base housing out there and everything else, and they were very nice to us. And I'd write to my wife. To
your
Jeanette.
Fiance, yeah.
Every day she'd write to me. Every day, we did that for about a year, and then in '62, we got married. I came back to Massachusetts, and we got married.
And you, tell me earlier that you met your wife in Plainville?
Yeah, in Plainville. Yeah. She worked at a crippled children's hospital.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's when I first met her, yeah. Then we got married, and I had three sons, Herb Jr., Joel.
Right.
And Corey.
Corey, who's accompanying you on this trip.
Yeah. And I have nine grandchildren from my three sons.
How lovely.
Yeah. Yeah. So they're just wonderful, wonderful, very close, very close.
When I was mentioning about the basketball and your time there with Suffolk, when I did a little research, I found out that you had the same number as Bob Cousy, who was number 14, who was the star player, and we've... We have this jersey for you,
a replica one
of the ones that you wore back then, with your name Santos on the back.
Oh, thank you.
Let me give you that.
Thank you. So much.
I had the good fortune myself to play basketball at Boston College for Bob Cousy.
Oh.
And Bob is still alive. He's 90 years of age.
No kidding.
Yeah, and I'll be seeing him. Next week, there's a new book coming out on him called
"The
Last Pass." On that, I found it very interesting that we have a real connection now.
Jeez.
You wearing number 14 and Cousy being Mr. Basketball and my idol growing up.
That's wonderful.
Well, yeah. But after your time in the Air Force, and you were stationed out in Reno at one time? How did you wind up in Reno? Was it because you were in...
Yeah, Stead Air Force Base.
Okay.
It was survival. type thing. They sent all the guys there for survival training because of the winters, and also the helicopters pilots trained there also because we have a lot of updrafts and everything, you know, mm-hmm. the mountains. And it was excellent training for those survivors.
Right.
Survivors.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so then you decided, were you married at that time with Jeanette?
No, that was in, we got married in 62.
Okay.
Yeah. I got out there in 61.
All right.
Yeah. I was there from 61 to 64.
Yes.
And then I decided to get out. They offered me become a major. I was a captain. They offered me major if I stayed in, but then they said I'd have to go to a remote site, and that was Newfoundland.
Mm-hmm. And okay.
I didn't want to leave the family, so I decided, no, to get out. So I took the bar in Nevada. Nevada.
Yeah. And,
passed the bar.
Yeah. Had you previously taken the bar in Massachusetts?
Oh, yeah. I took the bar in Massachusetts when I got out of law school and passed it. So I'm a member of the Massachusetts bar as well as Nevada. And then I decided to leave the
service.
Service, because I didn't want to go to Newfoundland because it was a remote site. I'd be there for 2 years without the family. You couldn't take your family with you. So I got out, and I got a job with the Reno City Attorney's Office.
Okay.
I prosecuted cases there, and that was for a couple of years. And then Bill Raggio, he was the district attorney, and he contacted me and asked me if I wanted to work for him in the district attorney's office. So I said yes. So I went over to the district attorney's office. I was a deputy district attorney. And boy, that was a wonderful experience.
How nice.
He was an outstanding prosecutor. We were called Raggio's Raiders. And he was just wonderful, yeah. Just wonderful. So I prosecuted cases there. And then we had a notorious criminal in Reno. His name was Jimmy Ng, little short guy, bald-headed, but he was really mean. And he'd pistol whip people.
Mm.
And he was head of, it was like he had his own mafia. I mean, if you committed a burglary in Reno, you'd have to give him something.
Oh, my.
On a burglary.
Yeah.
And he got so notorious. One time he told the chief of police, don't send any police over to my place because I'll shoot them. I mean, he was really something.
Hmm.
He committed a few murders that we know of.
Yeah.
So they had to get rid of him. So what they did was they contacted this guy in Los Angeles. He had all these paintings, expensive paintings.
Right, artwork.
Oh, yeah, very, very, very expensive. And they got a couple pictures from him, and they had him sell them to Ng. And Ng wanted more, so what they did was they planned it that they'd be bringing Ng more, and they'd meet at the, we had a motel on West 4th Street. And they were supposed to meet Ng there.
Mm-hmm.
And give them 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, whatever, paintings. They had a truckload of them, you know. So the police were all lined up on rooftops and everything as Ing was going over there to the motel. And when Ing got there, he got out of his car, started walking toward the motel. Then the police jumped out, and they told him, you know, halt.
Right, don't move. You know? Yeah.
And he started running back to the back of his truck because he had an automatic weapon in his
right.
truck with some other guns. He always carried guns around with him. So they start shooting at him. They must have shot him over 200 times.
Oh, my goodness. The real wild old west out there.
It was yeah. unbelievable.
My goodness.
And,
And after
some of the bullet holes went through some of the paintings, and they became more valuable because they had a story behind them.
Sure.
And one of my supervisors, Herb Allswede, what he did, he called my house, and this was before Ing got killed.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, because we were packing guns, all of us had a gun.
Yourself as well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And one night he called the house and he said to my wife, this is Jimmy Ing. He said, we're coming for Herb.
Oh, my.
She was so excited, you know, so frightened that.
Of course.
For a minute, she couldn't even say anything
yeah.
to me, you know. But then I said, calm down, tell me what happened. Then we found out it was Herb Allswede. So I yelled at him like crazy.
Oh, my.
The next day. But that's how they got Jimmy Ing.
Yeah. And then you went in, later you went into private practice.
Yeah, I went into private practice.
Right.
And
did you join a firm or did you start your own law firm?
No, I worked for an attorney there for a while. And then I met Al Monticelli. He had a travel agency. And I met him, and he was the chief license inspector for the Nevada Commission, Athletic Commission. And he always told me, he said, you want to get involved in boxing? And I said, I'd like to. So.
And that leads to your a second career that you've had for over 30 and almost 40 years as a boxing judge. So you were saying about how you got involved in that.
Yeah, he had me work judging amateur fights for about 2 years, and then he had me on professional fights, timekeeper, and then counting for the knockdowns.
Mm-hmm.
You know, as soon as somebody gets knocked down, you hit the apron, one, two, and then the referee sometimes picks up the count,
sure.
Yeah. And so then he used to take me to different fights, and he took me to Holmes and Shaver's fight. Shaver's was one of the hardest punchers you could find.
Ernie Shaver's, yeah.
Oh,
remember him?
He was some. The only trouble with him, he couldn't last more than four rounds.
Mm-hmm.
He'd run out of steam. But he hit Holmes one time so hard, I didn't think
Larry
Holmes would get up.
Yeah.
He was flat on the ground, but Holmes shook it off and got up. And then he beat him after the fourth, fifth round because Shavers couldn't do anything after that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he took me to the worst fight I saw was Holmes and Alley. I went to that fight. Boy, that was something. That the electricity in that fight was unbelievable.
Oh, sure.
People were trying to break in. They had gates all around, you know, they'd break in, sneak in, try to get a seat, you know. But that's when...
And we speak of Ali. Here's a photo with you and Ali later on in both of your careers at an event. And did you ever put the boxing gloves on yourself?
No, just we had boxing in high school. That's all, though.
Right.
And that picture there?
Please, yes.
Yeah, the one... Yeah, this one here. That's...
Maybe Corey can identify that fellow with the glasses on there.
That's Bruce Willis.
Yeah, Bruce Willis.
Bruce Willis, oh my goodness. Three celebrities there. Bruce Willis, Ali, and yourself that. But I understand that your son Corey is a two-time state of Nevada boxing champion.
Yeah.
And that your grandson, Jared, was a member of the University of Nevada Collegiate Boxing Championship team.
That's true. That's true.
Yeah. Did you ever secretly judge their fights?
No. I was every one of their fights, though.
Yeah.
And I would judge them as a... not judge them professionally, but I'd judge them... as they went along, you know, for my own self.
Of course, for your son and your grandson.
Yeah, they're wonderful, wonderful.
And you recently received the President's Award in 2016 from Nevada Boxing Hall of Fame.
Yeah.
And you continue to be an advocate for new safety measures in the sport of boxing. For greater contract benefits for boxers, and you also served on a committee to modernize boxing rules.
Yeah, when I was appointed by the governor, Richard Bryan, he said, "Herb, well, one thing I want you to do is rewrite the rules because they're all outdated."
Right.
You know, so that's what we did. We wrote the whole new rule book for unarmed combat.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Interesting. What do you see as far as the state of the future of boxing? As you probably well are aware, HBO is discontinuing their contract with boxing, and the Olympics are talking about eliminating it from the Olympic Games in the future. Do you still see there's an appeal for boxing?
Oh, yes. In fact, I don't know. It seems we're not too far from the Roman days.
Uh-huh.
People still like the blood and guts, you know, type thing. That's why MMA became popular and wrestling became popular. I think boxing is still going to make a comeback because we have such excellent boxers still.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you've judged 20 world championship fights, three heavyweight championship fights, ones with Evander Holyfield, Pinklin Thomas, Larry Holmes.
Yeah.
And on a local note, just down Route 24 from Boston is Brockton, Massachusetts, which is known as the City of Champions, of course, because of the great Rocky Marciano, 49-0. The only heavyweight undefeated champion.
Yeah. We at one fight, we met his son.
That was Peter.
Nice. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But Marciano, you couldn't beat him. I'm telling you, the guy was unbelievable.
Yeah, no one did. He had those short but powerful arms.
Oh, could he hit?
Yeah,
could he hit. Yes.
But it's also known for the City of Champions because of another fighter, Marvelous Marvin Hagler, and you were one of the judges for the Hagler, Tommy Hitman Hearns fight, which some describe, as the eight great continuous minutes of boxing before Hagler knocked off Hearns. And Sports Illustrated covered that fight, and that's the Sports Illustrated issue. Yeah. Can you tell us a little bit about that fight?
Oh, that was wonderful.
It was in Vegas.
It was in Vegas, open arena at Caesar's Palace. And the people, the people were unbelievable. They were in their best dress. Women had big jewelry on and everything. The excitement that they had
there—it was
just unbelievable. The audience was full of celebrities:
mm-hmm.
Bob Hope, Sylvester Stallone, Chevy Chase, Bo Derek, and her husband. It was just unbelievable, and the fight lasted only three rounds.
Right.
Boy, as soon as they went into action, it was nonstop.
Yeah.
And I remember Hagler got a cut on
his
head.
Correct.
And I think it made him more angrier, and he just...
The official, Richard Steele, actually stopped the fight for a brief time to have the doctor look at that cut.
Yeah. And I had Hagler winning each round, the three rounds.
Yeah, I think the first round you had him winning 10-8. He was so dominant coming out.
He was unbelievable.
Yeah.
And Hearns put up a good fight.
Yeah.
They just couldn't make it. He couldn't make it.
Yeah.
And then what's good about these fights, Don King used to have a huge party after, and of course we were invited, the commission was invited, and all the Hollywood stars would be there, and you could take pictures with them and everything, and the spread was unbelievable. they even had a pig. You know, a pig.
Bring back your old memory days from Plainville.
I know. No, I didn't eat any of the pig, you know. But everything, you know, all drinks, everything was free, you know. He used to put on some terrific parties after those fights.
Yeah. Now, you've judged fights of all weight divisions, from the heavyweights, Larry Holmes and Evander Holyfield, you know, the middleweight Sugar Ray Leonard, Marvin Hagler. And most recently, you and your son Corey were down in Tijuana, Mexico for the World Championship Bantamweight of Luis Neri and Jason Canoy.
Yeah.
And I think that wound up as a knockout in the third round as well.
Yeah, I know. That was a fantastic fight, too. It was so good having Corey with me judging the fights.
Mm-hmm.
It made me, you know, so proud, you know.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. Well,
I think you and Corey might be the only one of two father-son combinations that have judged professional boxing.
Yeah, I can't think of any others.
Yeah.
But it was just wonderful. It was just wonderful.
Now tell me, what is more difficult to judge? Is it the pounding of the heavyweights, or is it the relentless buzz of those bantamweights, the flurry of fights? Are they two different styles for the judging?
Yeah, two different styles. But to be a good judge, I think, is you have to have complete concentration because you have, on either side, you have photographers.
Right.
They're always trying to move over to your space to get pictures. So you got to push them aside and keep eyes on the fighters. Then you have the cornermen yelling at the fighter to do this and do that. And then you have the crowd yelling also. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of distractions. So concentration is the main thing in preparing for a fight. I watch fights on TV and I judge them and I compare my scores with the other judges when they come out with their decisions. But you've got to keep on preparing and also concentration. And I don't like to eat before a fight.
Okay.
You know,
interesting.
Of course, I don't drink, I don't smoke, so right. I don't have to worry about that stuff. But concentration is the main thing. You just have to, every second of that round, you have to know who's ahead. And if a boxer, they stop the fight like in Hearns, because
yes.
of the cut, what I normally do is I take my card over, my scorecard, and then put who's ahead at that point,
mm-hmm.
you know? Because, like I said, it takes a few minutes to check,
yeah.
cuts out. And
because if the fight doesn't go five rounds, they go to the cards,
yeah.
if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah.
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 Now, your eclectic career has even brought you to the silver screen, to movies, and you've appeared in such movies as Kingpin, Jane Austen's Mafia, Smoke and Aces, and The Last Dawn. How did that come about?
Oh, we knew, we found a friend who was in Nevada casting,
mm-hmm.
and she wanted us to take some classes in acting, so we did. And then whenever they shot a movie in Reno, you know, she would tell us and tell us to go to it, like the Kingpin,
mm-hmm.
and so we'd get roles, you know, like bowling. They started out with bowling and
okay.
Kingpin,
yes,
and then I remember one movie, Waking Up in Reno. They made it in Reno, and the part I had was the main actress was going up the stairways in a casino, and I was behind her.
Uh-huh.
You know, and sort of looking at her, you know.
Right.
So, but that's so much fun being
sure.
an extra.
Well, it was interesting to see yourself on the big screen on that.
Yeah.
Now, your three sons, Herb Jr., Joel, and Corey, are also lawyers.
Yeah.
And also, you have been a very supportive role model, along with your late wife, Jeanette, to them, and to your children and to your grandchildren. Any advice for someone who you might not know in terms of the legal profession and going into that? Also, I think you have a daughter-in-law that's a lawyer as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Corey's wife, yeah.
She, yeah.
Yeah. Being a lawyer, I mean, it's a wonderful, wonderful profession. And I advise anyone that's going into anything to do their best. That's the main thing. Do your best, whatever field you're going into. Always do your best. But law profession is wonderful. It's
yeah.
wonderful.
I suspect that this return to Suffolk University in Boston has brought back some very emotional and close memories for you.
Yes, wonderful, wonderful memories.
Yeah.
Yes.
What I'd also like to do, in addition to the jersey that you have from your Suffolk basketball days, We have a commemorative basketball here that says Suffolk University on it, has your name and the 2 degrees that you have. We'd like to present that to you as well.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you. Oh, yeah. That's wonderful. Jeepers creepers.
And maybe after our video here, we'll go down to the new gymnasium and we'll shoot a few hoops, see if you can make a couple of three-pointers on that.
Jeez. Yeah, I tried that with my son. He used to have the Reno Bighorns basketball team.
Right.
And but I couldn't shoot. I couldn't shoot anymore. It just seemed like my arms wouldn't just do it anymore.
It happens to us all over a period of time.
This is wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Oh, you're welcome. And any additional thoughts about Suffolk and your remarkable career that you'd like to share with us?
No, I just love Suffolk. It's just brought me so many memories and opportunities. It was just great. It was just great.
That's so very nice. And thank you for visiting with us, and we wish you continued success and good health.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you.
Thank you all.